that Revered Swami Goutamanandaji Maharaj is today present in our midst. He has kindly consented to deliver a lecture. He will speak on the subject regular practice of Jopa, prayer and meditation is a must. It's a rare privilege to hear such an elderly and experienced sadhu like him on such vital subject. Revered Maharaj, ever active, ever energetic, and also is a good writer and orator too. He always wears a sweet smile on his face, is ready to talk on spiritual matters to anyone at any time. Revered Maharaj has been carrying on his sadhana as well as swadhyaya over several decades. He is remarkably steadfast in his sadhana, spiritual practices, and is a true sadhaka. The other day, one of the brahmacharis of Chennai Mutt expressed his happiness to me, saying that Revered Maharaj is the right person to deliver the talk on such subject related with spiritual practices. This brahmachari, who has been staying in Chennai Mutt for about 8 to 9 years, said to me that Revered Maharaj, not even for a single day, was seen to miss to come to the temple in the mornings as well as in the evenings to sit there for regular spiritual practices. Revered Maharaj has unbounded love and affection for all of us, especially for the young and energetic brahmacharis. Despite his extremely busy schedule, he has taken so much trouble to respond positively to our invitation. In fact, Revered Swami Prabhanandaji Maharaj took the initiative to send an invitation to him on our behalf. We all feel, Revered Maharaj, blessed to have your holy self with us at the training center. We offer our devotee pranams at your feet. Now I request Revered Maharaj to deliver his talk.
Om Sthapakaya cha Dharmasya Sarva Dharma Swarupine Avatara Varishthaya Ramakrishnaya Te Namaha. My dear, I am in charge of Madras Mutt for about more than 14 years. I was very proud to have been head of Along Center for 13 years before. I was holding a record. No other mantra stayed in Along for 13 years as head. But that record has been broken by my stay in Madras Mutt. And the reason for that may be the attraction of that center. When I was in charge of Sharda Peeth here, before I was posted to Madras Mutt in 1995. So I requested our President Maharaj, please don't me post from here, don't post me from here to Madras, because I will be away from Belur Mutt. So let me be here itself. I had spent 3 years in Sharda Peeth. Then Revered Bhuteshananji Maharaj and Revered Ranganathananji Maharaj, both of them told, we are not posting you away from Belur Mutt. That is our second Belur Mutt. You are going to second Belur Mutt. So when I went there, both these great Swami's words were literally true, and everyone experiences it. You don't feel in any way you are away from Belur Mutt there. It is that atmosphere that inspires everyone, not only me, so many Swamis there and Brahmacharis there. They are naturally inspired to dedicate themselves to spiritual life as well as the life of seva, our karma yoga. Both these things are very highly balanced there in Madras Mutt. In many of the centers it may be there, but we are there amidst that very balanced life. So with this short remark, let me go into the subject of today. Regular practice of japa, prayer and meditation is a must for every monastic member of our order. When you say, or when we say, regular means it should be daily and at appointed hours. In our tradition, so from Sri Ramakrishna downwards, so we have been following this regular practice. That means regular means daily, there should be no break. And then there is no holiday for spiritual practices. No Sunday, no Saturday, no Wednesday or any other day. Amavasya, Purnami, there is nothing. So it is a continuous process, daily, regular. And daily also, at the regular appointed time, Sri Ramakrishna, the avatar of the age, he would just, if it is evening, it is getting dusk, the day is passing away into night. In the evening, he would just look at his hand. If he could not count the hairs on the hand, he would say, oh, now it has become evening. There was no wristwatch at that time. Even if it was there, perhaps he would not have used it. He who could not keep a cloth on his body, what wristwatch would he have used? So he would look at the hand. If he could not count the hairs, he would say, now it has become evening. Let us think about God. He was thinking about God always, but he would go deep into that mood, indicating that we people who are starting spiritual life must be very, very particular about the evening and the morning. Early morning and early evening. These two are very, very auspicious, very, very desirable times for meditation. So from that time onwards, when we say regular practice of spiritual practices, we mean daily without any break, and appointed times we shall never miss. Morning and evening is regular time for every one of us to do it. Many times when you have all been in different centers for 2 years, 3 years, you yourself are experienced persons in this matter, that in many centers, right at that time you may be busy with so many things. All of you were allotted some duty. So you would feel sometimes, let me finish this one. So now it is just, bell has gone for the aarti. Let me finish this one, go 5 minutes late to the aarti. That will not work. Sri Ramakrishna, what did he say? If you cannot count the hairs on your hand, immediately you must go. There is no order superseding Sri Ramakrishna's order that you can go late to the aarti. You may take law into your own hands. You will pay penalty for it. You will not get any price for that. So for meditation, there is no alternative. There is no superseding authority for Sri Ramakrishna. We must make time for morning and evening and daily. So this is what we mean by regular. And there are hundreds of our Swamis doing it. When once it becomes routine, we can ourselves see there are so many other items in our life which has become a routine. We do it almost to the strike of the hour or just at the right time. For example, our breakfast. So as soon as the bell is there, all of us are ready. You see, very rarely, very rarely somebody comes late for the breakfast table or for the lunch or for the night food. In our time, the early morning breakfast was one small cigarette cup full, cigarette tin used to be there. You remember this much. So one cup full of mudi and one cup of tea. This was our breakfast. And sometimes we would go late by 2 minutes, and that would have been taken away by somebody. You go without. So we were so regular. At that time, stroke of the hour, we are there. It became a part and parcel. Nobody would be late by more than one minute or half, 1.5 minutes. We are regular, we can be regular. If we can be regular, why not for meditation? Only it's the question of Shiva Sankalpa Mastu. We have to make that will work. Sankalpa is the power of the will, determination. If you determine it, no, Thakur has told, let me adhere by that. One day, 2 days, 3 days, then we will fall in line. Naturally, just as we go for breakfast, we go for japa and meditation also, our prayers also. So this regular practice, that means uninterrupted by any day and by any, other than these two regular times, you must hold on. But that is, there is no rule that you should not meditate for more than two times in a day. You can meditate 4 times in a day. Many people meditate also. And many of the senior Swamis used to advise. So you must meditate 4 times in a day. Then only it is effective. So morning you do. And then we eat 4 times, isn't it? Why not take spiritual food also 4 times? 3-4 times physical food we can digest and we feel healthy. Why not spiritual food also? So we can meditate at 12 o'clock at the noon also. Then night also, after the evening meditation, another session before we go to bed. It may be at 11 o'clock, it may be at 10 o'clock, or it may be 12 o'clock. So you can meditate and then go to sleep. So very natural. See, 6 cycles, you feel a hunger. So this regularity we must keep in our mind. And every monastic member means everyone that are inside our mission. We are at different levels of spiritual practices. So some of us are senior Swamis, some are junior Swamis, some are Chaitanya Brahmacharis, some are probationer, some are pre-probationers. All of us are monastic members. Every one of us have to follow this one. Following means nobody else will come and force upon you. We have to force ourselves because it's a voluntary discipline. We have ourselves accepted. Therefore, there should be no bitterness about this one. So, Bhava Maharaj, the first principal of this training center, he would again and again tell, you see, we are all willing slaves. We are slaves, no doubt. We work for Guru Maharaj just at the behest. Guru Maharaj's successor, Brahmananda Swami, Swami Vivekananda, then direct disciples, their disciples, and our President Maharaj, Vice President, they are all Guru Maharaj's different forms. They order, we obey. We don't question. Just like slaves, we are slaves. What is the difference between the Negro, the slaves there, and us? We are willing slaves. We have ourselves come. Nobody asked you to come. I myself came. You yourself came. We are willing slaves. When we have, what did we will? Let me be the servant of Sri Ramakrishna. Let this life go. Let me obey his order. And what will be the result? I will get his grace. So if I am obedient to him, so he will oblige me. He will bless me. He will shower his grace upon me. His grace is releasing us from this bondage of body and mind. As Shankara says, moksha. Not that we go into some other loka and sit there and enjoy amrita. No. The Shankaracharya's moksha is this sharira, deha, manas, ahankara, the bandhanath. From the bondage of our body and the ego inside it, to feel that we are not the body, we are not the ego, we are that pure atma. This feeling that we are the children of God, we are divine lights, we are the atman. We were never born, we never die, we never suffer. We are all full of Sachidananda. This experience must come. This is real moksha. Guru Maharaj's grace, we are going to get it. Why I said Guru Maharaj's grace is, that is the essence of all our sadhana. We will come to that point further. It is for his grace we serve him. And we serve him because we have ourselves come to become his servants. Nobody called us. So we have come. I surrendered myself to you, Guru Maharaj. I will serve you. In return, you must give me moksha. This is your understanding. There is a beautiful song in Kannada. The devotee goes on telling, I will do my part of the duty. Oh Lord, you must also do your part of the duty. So this is binding upon me. In Kannada language they say, Nanagu Aane. That means it is binding upon me. Ninagu Aane. You are also bound. So I serve you with all my heart, but you must also bestow your grace upon me and give me what I want. Such a sweet relations. So we have elected our own master and he has accepted us. This sweet relationship, we are willing slaves. We have ourselves surrendered ourselves. There is no question of retreating back. No, I will leave the order and go. What? You yourself have come. It is, why should you go back? Have you become so weak-willed? That idea of going away from the order, not liking the order, this idea must be rooted out. Let the worst come. I have decided I will serve Guru Maharaj all my life. The day one when may come. So we are the willing slaves. Our relationship with Sri Ramakrishna is, we are his sweet slaves. And we expect from him his grace. His grace is always flowing. The elders say, his grace is flowing always. The moment we find we have unfurled our sails, his grace we feel. We are not feeling it now. We come to feel. So this every monastic member, nobody should say, should think, oh, they are senior Swami, they are able to do. We should not try like that. No, everybody can do, should do from the day one. Trying to meditate as many times as possible and then regularly as much as possible. And of course, when there is pressing duty, etc., etc., preventing you from following this, following the right timings in every day, there are so many ways. We are all very intelligent boys. We are the pick in the society. We have been picked up. We are the best products in society. So we can find out our own way. Suppose some time you are forced to be away from the meditative hours, you can always say, oh Swami, to the head of the center or anybody, we can say, Swami, as soon as just by only 15 minutes, I will do my routine 108 japa and I will come and then finish your work. Nobody will have the heart to say, when you say, I will do finish japa in 15 minutes and come. Nobody will say no. You can come after half an hour also, then nobody will object. You may come after 1 hour also. We have done it. So, always there is a day when once you have got the will, Shubha Sankalpa. So, this regularity in practice is one thing. We must determine within ourselves. We shall keep it up. Then, japa, prayer and meditation, we have our own tradition. What japa we will do, what prayers do we will do, what meditation we do, how do we meditate, this is all in our tradition coming down from Sri Ramakrishna himself. So he, hundreds of ways of meditation suited to hundreds of temperaments have come down in the tradition. Our gurus have taught us. So according to the way they have taught us, we must hold on to the parampara. So the japa, so we say, so this has come down right from Sri Ramakrishna. What mantra we do, japa today, this japa has a continuity. It has come out from the mouth of Sri Ramakrishna, mouth of Holy Mother, mouth of Swami Vivekananda, from the direct disciples. Once, we had the opportunity of asking Swami Yatishwarananji, Maharaj, so you give us the mantra, how do you give us the mantra? So, he said, don't think that we give you anything new. What we have received from our gurus, we are giving you. And those gurus, what they have received, they have given us. So, from Sri Ramakrishna, directly, living mantra is coming to you. And mantra, and the person indicated by that mantra, Nama and Nami, they are inseparable. Where mantra is there, that God also is there. So we have got the name. If we go on repeating it, so the God is there along with us. We feel his presence. So senior Swamis used to tell us, you may not have the Nami, but Nama you have got. When Nama is there, Nami must come. They are tied to one another. Where Nama is there, Nami must be there. Only I am not feeling it. We will also feel it. So do japa, they used to tell. So that living mantra has come to us. And how to do that japa, etc., all your gurus have told. So follow that one meticulously. We should not think anything is unimportant, because we may feel unimportant. Every little thing has got a significance in the spiritual instruction. In Brahmananji's teachings, you see, he says in one place to one of his disciples, were all great. Each one was a great stalwart. One of them he is telling, you don't follow the literally what I tell. That is why you get restless. Brahmananji is telling his disciple, you don't follow literally what I say. That is why you get restless. That means every word they have told us, there is a meaning in it. We may not understand it. We may think it is unimportant. Let us overcome. Let us not bother about this. No. Even if you don't understand, follow. So this is the method we follow. Guru's instruction should be followed meticulously. In Bangalore, there was a HMT factory, Japanese collaboration. That was one of the very first factories in India with Japanese collaboration, and that was a very successful one. Now it is in a very bad condition, but that was one of the very successful ventures. In that HMT, they have so many people, assembly people are there, ordinary laborers. They are all taught, you must do simple things. So they will go on doing the same thing throughout the 8 hours of the shift. One of the things that was given was to one of the workers, there is a small spring in that assembly. He has to take a wooden hammer of this size. He has to strike 14 times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 14 times and pass it on to the next stage. This he will go on doing for 8 hours. This fellow, after 1 or 2 or 3 days, got somehow or other disinterested in giving 14 strokes. What 14 strokes? What does it matter if I give 12? So he gave 12 only and passed on. And after this, 1 or 2 days, he thought, suppose I give 10, what does it matter? No complaint has come. 4 days I have sent. So he came down to like that, 6 strokes. From 14, he is giving only 6 strokes. So that Japanese officer, on that day he was there. So let me go and see your assembly line. When he come and then sees this one fellow is giving only 6 strokes and passing it on. Stop, he said. How many strokes are you asked to give? Then he got confused. 14. How many strokes are you giving now? 6. Why? Sir, it doesn't matter. How do you know it doesn't matter? We have experimented for years together. And we know what is the strength of the spring is. And what is the weight of this hammer is. And what is your powers, usually human power in your finger. With all these three together, that will bring it to such tension of the spring. It will last for 15 years, 16 years and the watch will go on. And you say, it doesn't matter. What experiment have you done? Do you know it? We have experimented over it over years. We should remember, small things in spiritual life, they have experimented. You sit in asana, keep your back straight, keep your chest and neck and face in straight line. This looks small, a small instruction. What does it matter if I lean back? No, it doesn't. It has been practiced for thousands of years. So we must give importance to our religious, our gurus, our religious teachers, our elders. So we must, as far as possible, if you have any doubt, we can go and ask, sir, we felt that this is not very important. Then they will explain to you, no, that I have heard from our guru. So he also thought that later on he got benefits. Then we shall know every bit of their advice has a meaning. So this japa is there, prayer also is there. Prayers, how many hundreds of types of prayers? Sri Ramakrishna has introduced prayer, as one of our senior swamis said, as the main sadhana in our spiritual practice is prayer. This prayer, and Sri Ramakrishna never depended upon any book, neither Chandi, nor Stotra Manjari, nor Bhagavad Gita. He never thought reciting any one of these is a prayer. It must come from the heart. It need not be poetic at all. Speak. See Sri Ramakrishna's prayer in the Kathamrita from beginning to end. Very few of them. He sings a song after first praying in his own way. Just as we speak to our father or mother or our brothers or sisters, he says, mother, you see, you are there. and then you were there watching me all the while. I fell down, I broke my hand. How can this happen? It's a prayer. He's complaining to mother. So, I have been with me, and then how did I fall down and break my hand? Afterwards, he sings a song. First, you know, he tells what comes from his heart directly to God. This type of prayer, hundreds of prayers are there. Every one of us can benefit from that. So this is a tradition. Through songs, through, of course, the traditional stotras are there. And speak to God what you feel like. On the first day when you come, you have got more to pray than the senior people. Senior people, they don't have much to pray. They have known the grace of Guru Maharaj. Even without prayer, he is answering. But you are all newly beginning. You feel that nobody is there. So you should. You have got many things to pray. And all that comes into your mind, whether it is your difficulty or whether it is your joy, whether you feel gratified with something that you have got, or whether you are offended that I have not got this, everything can be expressed to God, whose presence we feel. In our prayers, we feel God is our own, He is with us, He loves us. This is Sri Ramakrishna's God for us. Sri Ramakrishna's God does not sit in Vaikuntha or Kailasa and then there He passes orders. That does not. He is sitting in our own heart as our mother, as our father, as a great benefactor who is eager to help us in every way. And so, knowing such a person, He is in front of us, we must pray. Prayer is almost like speaking to God. Speaking to God is prayer. That is how we have prayed when we were small children. We went to our father or we went to our mother. Ma yata diyada, ma wata da, yata na dile ami, kaan goye kaan, na goda gadi diye kaan pe, goda gadi pe, jit kurbe. All these things we do. It's all through words, through speaking. Prayers, real prayers from the heart, they come from the heart in the form of our speech. We can speak to God. If we think when I go to prayer, instead of saying, oh, I am going to pray, instead of thinking, I am going to tell God today whatever I have to say. He has done like this, so first he has done one or two good things, I thank him, afterwards I will take him to task. Decide like this, go and sit for the prayer. Prayer will be interesting to you and perhaps it will be interesting to him also. This fellow is coming with so many things, he will also become alert. Prayer must be so intimate, so free. We should feel free to go to prayer. Prayer is something God, talking to your friend, talking to our beloved. So this prayer, this is our tradition. From Guru Maharaj downwards, we talk, we express our feelings to him. We also utter prayers also. Prayers are also, very good prayers are there. Some of them prayers are very, very moving. When you tell that one, automatically you are moved to tears. Such prayers you can utter. So Sri Ramakrishna has taught this one, direct disciples have taught this. This prayer must come into our life. Mahapurusha Maharaj used to go to the extent where he met one young man in south, maybe Madurai or somewhere. And then this young man came to Mahapurusha Maharaj and then said, "Sir, I am not able to meditate because I have read Swami Vivekananda. He has asked meditation is the key to all knowledge. So I am trying to meditate, I am unable to meditate from so many months." Then Mahapurusha Maharaj, at that time he was quite aged, maybe 70 years or so, or 60 years, past 60. He looked at this young man and they said, "You give up meditation," he said. Then that young man was upset. "What? Swami Vivekananda has asked us to meditate. Meditation is the key. And this Swami, he is telling you give up meditation." Then, you know, after a few minutes, Shivananji himself started, "Mahapurusha Maharaj, what you can do is, if you are unable to meditate, doesn't matter. You keep a picture of Sri Ramakrishna in front of you, shedding tears from your heart, in your eyes. Pray to Guru Maharaj's picture. Please give me your grace. Please answer my prayer. Please solve my problems. Please shed your grace upon me." You pray to Sri Ramakrishna, shedding tears, sincere tears. You will see the prayer will mature into contemplation. Contemplation with meditate will mature into meditation. Meditation will bring you samadhi also. Start with prayer. See, Mahapushmaraj is such a great man. Meditation is the right royal way. And when it becomes deeper and deeper, we can go into samadhi also. So this is our parampara, is the tradition. So if we try this one, all of us can easily go to very high stage with very little effort. So we in the parampara, when we say, we follow certain rules to begin the spiritual life. These rules can be described as follows. We should pray to God sincerely from the depth of one's heart. This Sri Ramakrishna goes on telling again and again, Vyakulata Rashonge Prarthana Kurte Hode. We must have Vyakulata, yearning, Vyye, not year, Vyer, Nang. So, yearning for God, yearning is Vyakulata. So, this Vyakulata, when we study the life of Sri Ramakrishna himself, so this Vyakulata, yearning from the heart, desiring to see God, have a vision of Guru Maharaj, have a vision of Mother, it comes only when there is Vairagya. When you are disgusted with the world, there is nothing in this world which can be of that great joy, infinite joy, nothing can give as the vision of God. When this Vairagya for the world is there, then Vyakulata comes. So Vairagya we must develop. If Vyakulata has to continue, that Vairagya must also continue. Renunciation. The idea that world holds nothing. There is no joy in the world. Whatever joy is in the world is very transitory, very short-lived when compared to the infinite joy of God. So this Vairagya must be cultivated also. But this Vairagya, it does not come so easily unless we have some sadguna, what we call as values, spiritual values. Value is an economic word. Value of so-and-so is so many dollars, so many bullion we say. That is the economic term. Now we apply it to spirituality also. See, values of life means sadguna, dharmika gunas. The gunas that is dharmika must have. The sadguna, the good qualities that spiritual person must have. Atmika gunas. So this is called values of life. The greatest value Sri Ramakrishna suggests is to have this viveka, always alert. Viveka is seeing what is good and what is bad. As soon as you see, you must be able to decide. This is the viveka buddhi. Buddhi itself means viveka buddhi. This viveka buddhi becomes alert and very sharp. You don't have to go on arguing whether it is good or bad. As soon as you say, hey, go, this is bad, you immediately judge. So this viveka to be alert is, Sri Ramakrishna says, we have got to cultivate three qualities. One is truthfulness. Sri Ramakrishna, a spiritual person must be truthful. If a person is not truthful, he is not spiritual. If a person is spiritual, he must be truthful. You cannot say he is a very highly spiritual man, but he speaks untruth. You cannot say it. He is an untruthful person, but he is a highly spiritual. You cannot say. These two cannot go together. Sri Ramakrishna's criterion, all the saints and seers' criterion is a truthful person alone can be spiritual. So every one of us, when we come to spiritual life, truthfulness is this spiritual value we must cultivate. Sri Ramakrishna go to the extent of saying, this truthfulness a person follows, that is the tapasya for the Kali Yuga. We are in the Kali Yuga, whether we want it or not, we are in the Kali Yuga. So we want to do tapasya also. Many of our senior swamis, you must be hearing, they go for tapasya also. Sri Ramakrishna said, the best tapasya for the Kali Yuga is follow truthfulness. Be 100% truthful. Never swerve from truth for whatever reason. Give up your life, but don't swerve from the truth. He who speaks the truth, Sri Ramakrishna says in the Kathamrita, he who speaks always the truth, he is already sitting on the lap of God. God is there behind him also. If a man speaks truth, God is there behind him. If God is behind you, what fear you have got? You have achieved everything. So truthfulness is such a great quality. if you are truthful, automatically your discriminative faculties becomes very sharp. Then the Vyakulata will come. Then we pray to God from our heart, and our heart desire will be fulfilled. We can have a vision of God. So truthfulness is to be cultivated at all costs. Along with the truthfulness, another great quality with all the Swamis, from Sri Ramakrishna downwards, from the direct disciples to our own gurus and our senior Swamis, is chastity, purity, brahmacharya. Brahmacharya, chastity, purity is so much stressed. So as Nirantaranandji was referring to Swami Yatishwaranandji's adventures in spiritual life, his another magnum opus, very important book, is Meditation and Spiritual Life. It has been translated into all the languages, also many languages. We have translated it into Tamil. In that book, you get everything in such details. It is one of the masterly books. We have rarely an authoritative book on meditation according to our Ramakrishna Sampradaya, as you find in that book, because many people have told me, our own senior Swamis, this Swami Yatishwaran had an advantage of knowing the spiritual life in the East. He was one of the stalwart disciples of Brahmanandaji. And he has spent about 16 years in the West. And he has studied the psychology of the West and Westerners. And he had guided hundreds of people into success in spiritual life. So he knows the mind of whole humanity, the East and the West, the Eastern psychology and the Western psychology. With this background, he has written the authoritative teachings he has received from Swami Brahmananji downwards. So this book is so authentic. Therefore, I quote a small quotation from there about this brahmacharya. Because we don't have the good fortune of having long discourses on brahmacharya by the direct disciples. So here is a person who has heard. So how in detail he writes. So on page 205, Meditation and Spiritual Life, without brahmacharya, says Swami Yatishwaranandaji, there can be no spiritual life. Seeing the divine in all is the only practical solution for brahmacharya. Seeing the divine in all, including ourselves. I should feel I am the divine Atman, not my body, not my mind. My mind may be having all sorts of good or bad thoughts or mixed thoughts. I am not that mind. I am behind that pure Atman. So this idea that we are pure ever, whatever may be your mind, whatever may be your body, we are different from that. He says, seeing the divine in all is the only practical solution for this brahmacharya. Think you are the self. Think you are the Atman, the pure light of consciousness. Drive down this idea of Atman into the depths of your mind. If you look upon yourself a star of light, then everyone will become a star of light for you. Here is the secret. As I think about myself, I think about others. If I think I am the body, then I think of others also as the body. If I think I am the mind with full of good and bad passions, I think of others also like that, good or bad. If I think that I am the pure Atman, I think of everybody else also as pure Atman. So Swamiji refers to this point. So if you think yourself as a star of light, you will think of others also as star of light. That means everywhere we see God, we see divine. Here, Swami Yatishwaranji quotes one Brother Giles. Brother Giles, he was one of the foremost disciples of Saint Francis of Assisi, who was only a peasant before he joined Saint Francis of Assisi. Saint Francis of Assisi is very much relished by all the Indian spiritual people, because he was one of a very true bhakti yogini. There is a book itself on Saint Francis of Assisi written by a Kerala Christian, very very erudite person. Saint Francis of Assisi, the bhakti yogini. It may be in your library also. Very popular book. This man was just a bhakti yogi, dedicating his whole life as a bhakta to God, praying for his grace and spending his whole life. his disciple, these guides. I myself have not read the original book, but Yatishwaranji quotes from him. That itself is so attractive. Brother Gail says, Yatishwaranji is quoting, Brother Gail says, amongst all the other virtues, I would set virtue of chastity first. Because Gail says, sweet chastity contains all perfection itself. But there is no other virtue which can ever be perfect without chastity. Chastity is sweet by itself. It is complete. It is perfect. Any other virtue without chastity would be incomplete. So he says, sweet chastity contains all perfection in itself. But there is no other virtue which can ever be perfect without chastity. Here, I refer you further to for some more beautiful remarks on Brahmacharya, more details, quite a lot of detail, to Swami Yatishwaranji's book, Meditation and Spiritual Life, Chapter 13, Practice of Brahmacharya, one of the best chapters in that book. So, this is purity. First I spoke about truthfulness. Second is chastity. This is our sadhana. With this sadhana, the third one is, we have to cultivate selflessness. Selflessness means putting ourselves behind, allowing others to go in front. Give the priority to others for all things. For all good things, let others have first. Let me be the last. So our self must be reduced to the last and least position, so that our real self will manifest. This ego, when it becomes less, the real Atman behind will manifest. Swami Yatishwaranji would always say, you see, what is the thing we always meditate upon, which we will never forget, without any effort? He would himself give the answer, our ego. Our ego is the one object about which we go on meditating always. Never there is a break, no break at all. I, always. Even in dream we don't forget our ego. Even waking state we don't forget our ego. Continuous meditation on ego. He says, unless this ego is replaced by the Brahma Bhava, not I, O Lord, Thou. Not I, but Thou. Naham, Naham, Tuhu, Tuhu, Sri Ramakrishna used to say. You, you, not me, not me. So this, putting our self behind and making others go in front. Slowly, slowly we have to cultivate this selflessness. Swami Yatishwaranji always used to say, I always consider people, whether they are sannyasins or householders, great if they have selflessness. Grihasthas are also great to the extent they are selfless. This is the criterion he would apply. He had one American disciple, if I remember his name was, I think, Overton or somebody. I may not be very correct. He used to come to Bangalore. He was an American disciple. Very selfless man. So he was not a very rich person. But whatever he had, he would try to give others. In philanthropy, he would help. He would come every year to Bangalore Ashrama to see the necessities of Swami Yatishwaranda, who was his guru. And whatever was the need of the ashrama. In his own way, he would do something every year and go. One day, we came to know about this Overton. We came to know that he had married 3 times. So, we lost all respect for this man. But Yatishwaranji had great respect for him. Very great love for him. One day, one of us, casually, we remarked, Swami, he has married 3 times. We said, what of that? Swami Yatishwaranji said, what of that? How unselfish he is. How unselfish he is. And later on he added, you see, in their society, I am talking of 1950s, in their society, you have a wife, otherwise you cannot stay in society. You are not respected. Therefore, his 2 wives passed away. So he has married for the 3rd time. It is nothing wrong. Even in India, we have got so many cases. Marrying 3rd time, it is not a fault. A spiritual people may have a 3rd wife, but what is the history? We did not know that. Because he has got a 3rd wife, we all condemned him. Yatishwaranji said, no. How unselfish he is. Unselfishness is a great quality even in householders, what to speak of Swamis. I have seen Yatishwaranji also here. He would come and stay here for 1.5 months in a year. So I was here in the training center at that time, 60 and 61. So 60 and 61. So we had that opportunity of serving him for 1.5 months. In 61, at that time, sometimes he would not be very well. On that day he would tell us, please don't allow anybody to come and touch me. If it today I am not well, I am running temperature. So we would tell all the Swamis. They would go to salute Maharaj. Maharaj Bolachen, Aaj Vona Shurita Bhalana, Paach Viya Pranam Kurar Vatich Diyona Bolachen. And most of them would listen to. One senior Swami was there. We need not bother about his name. But when I told him also, Na, Pataki Achi, you just brushed us aside, went and wanted to touch the feet of Maharaj. Maharaj, Nana, Pachuana, Chuana, don't touch me. He is shouting. Even then the Swami went and touched his feet and walked away. Maharaj was so much upset. Then he did not say anything. Selfish. He was considering that is selfishness. You see, one day I am ill, I am asking not to salute, but you want to get something from me. So he is selfish. Whether he gets it or not is different. But his intention is, you see, oh, so upset, he would not tell any other bad word. Selfish. This selfishness, it got imprinted in your mind. Whenever I feel that I am selfish in somewhere, we are not so much aware. Many times we are selfish without our knowing also. But whenever I feel conscious that I am selfish, I try to discard it off because of that great teaching, unselfishness. These three sterling qualities are to back up our viveka buddhi, our discrimination. If we have to be alert that we are come for spiritual life, so we should always take spiritual things and unspiritual things, we must keep it out. If that viveka buddhi is to be there, we must be truthful, we must be pure, we must live a brahmachari life. And it is so easy. Sri Ramakrishna has given us this fortress, the fortress of the Sangha. There is no place in the world, some of us, even including your principal, we have gone out of India also and seen other parts of the world. This is the fortress where purity reigns. You don't have to search for purity. Just fall in the line of your duties. At the time of the duties, do the duties. At the time of meditation, you meditate. At the time of study, you study. At the time of sleep, sleep very well. Don't miss the tip. And you will become a first class brahmachari. You don't have to struggle for purity. Purity is there in this organization. This is the fortress. As Sri Ramakrishna used to say, Eta Kalir Kella. About Dakshineswari used to say, Eta Kalir Kella. Balram Bose body, Kalir Vaitakanapit. He used to meet people there in Balram Babu's house. He said that is drawing room of Kali. Here, Dakshineswar, this is the fort of Kali. Whoever comes here, they are protected from everything. So this is the Kella, this Belur Mutt, all the centers associated with this one. Yatishwaran used to say, this is the purity, a spiritual current is going on special. A very, very interesting conversation comes to my mind. Once we were just talking about, you see, God is everywhere, Sri Ramakrishna also is everywhere. Why we talk so much about Sri Ramakrishna centers, our mission centers, especially? He said, no, there is a special current of Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna is everywhere, there is no doubt. His current is flowing everywhere, there is no doubt. But he used to say, there is a special current of Sri Ramakrishna flowing in his centers. And when you are doing the sadhana, this is his words, if you come into touch with this flow, this special flow of spiritual current of Sri Ramakrishna, your spiritual practices become rather easy. You don't have to struggle. So in his centers, there is a special that keeps your mind above your body and mind consciousness, and you lead a pure life. This is what is all brahmacharya is about, purity is about, selflessness is about. So this purity, truthfulness and selflessness, if these three virtues are nourished in us, inside us, we will have viveka, we will have vairagya, we will have vyakulata, and our prayers will be really from our heart. All that we desire will be answered. Sri Ramakrishna is the authority for that one. If we can pray with all our heart, Muni Shunbe Ni Shunbe, God will certainly listen to our prayers and He will grant our prayers. One should pray to God sincerely from the depth of one's heart. This is one of the fundamental rules of our sadhanas. One should turn to prayer in the early hours of the morning and at the sunset hours of the evening minimum. So we can do it several times also. As we proceed, when we get joy in our japa and in our prayers, you can pray at any time. Even after, sometimes you know we have watched so many, we read this and that literature about this prayer and meditation and japa and we get confused. When we were in the beginning stages, when we were going to Yatishwaran Swami, we read one book on japa, written by that Divine Life Society, published by them. All sorts of japa, all sorts of rules and restrictions are written there. So, we went and asked Swami Yatishwaranji, Maharaj, in that one it is written, when you do japa, you must face this such and such a direction and do japa. Then he immediately turned to us. You see, I turn this way sometimes and do japa. I turn this way and do japa. In any direction I sit and do japa. And I get all the joy of the japa. He did not say, don't care for that book. He said, our sampradaya is there. We don't care for any direction. Because our all direction is Guru Maharaj is there. You can sit in any direction. These are all spurious rules. So our parampara is what our gurus have given. We don't insist on the small, small rules. Main thing is vyakulata, from the heart you pray. And minimum to start with two times, never fail. Hold on to this. One should practice moderation in food so that stomach should be light at the time of meditation. Always the moderation is food also is insisted by all our gurus and senior teachers, especially about Swami Yatishwaranandaji. He was very particular, he would be very sarcastic. If somebody overate, usually he would never comment on anybody. But if he found any of our Swamis overeating, he could not bear that. Because what an amount of harm we are doing. You see, by overeating, so we are unable to meditate and do japa and prayer. So what an amount of harm it is doing to us. It is further to know, he would cast very caustic remarks. One senior Swami, so he had eaten, overeaten. So they went and told him, he was in Madras Mutt at that time. So Swami, Maharaj, so and so has eaten so many sweets today and in that Bandara. Said, if I were there in that Bandara, I would ask him to get out from that place. Mane, he did not approve of that, overeating at all. Eat well, doesn't matter. Eat as much as you can digest. And our main purpose is all must lead us to our prayers, and through prayer our vision of the Lord and our getting to the goal of life for which we have come. So one should practice moderation food just as a spiritual discipline. Other spiritual disciplines can be followed well with this moderation. Food itself may not be a spiritual thing, but food can spoil our spiritual meditations. So we must be careful about it. If prayers could be continued after that, this was just my remark. If we can tune ourselves with the program of a particular center, here in Belur, we have got early morning Mangalarti and evening prayer, set time. Suppose I make myself free and just meticulously attend these two, that itself, it's enough. Automatically after the prayer you are in the mood, you sit in any one of the timsar in the main temple itself, you meditate and pray in the morning, in the evening. So your prayer and meditation also is over. You have attended the routine also. So it goes smooth. After a little time you will find you are tuned to this one without your own knowledge, and you are spiritually improving. So it is better ourselves to tune to the particular program It is, now we are in Belur, but it may be in Madras Mutt, it may be in any other Mutt where you are. Tune yourself to the routine, and the prayer and meditation should be tuned along with it. It becomes very easy. Between the two prayers, that means in the morning and in the evening, we should keep our thoughts, speech and actions. All our activities are through thoughts, through our speech and through action. All the three actions should be directed towards Thakur through doing useful works allotted or chosen. We may ourselves must have selected some duties, and allotted duties are there for us, thinking that it is all works are to be considered service to Thakur or puja of Thakur. This will give joy and enthusiasm. We are all allotted duties. So if we think it is their allotted duty, there is no joy in it. Work is work. But suppose we think whatever duty is given to us, at the end of each work, we may be working for 2 or 3 or 4 hours at a stretch. Mentally, if we offer the work and its fruit, saying that it is Thakur's work, it is Sri Ramakrishna's service I am doing through my work. Thakur, you have made me work all this time. You are the real doer. Thakur has got it done through us. Got it done through us. We may not be aware, but that is the real truth. He has brought us here, and he is getting the work done through us. You are attending this class, you are finishing the training center, you are going back to your center. You do. You are not doing. Thakur is getting it done through you. So you are progressing in spiritual life through that. So if we can say at the end of every 3 or 4 hours of our work, Thakur, you have made me work all this time. You are the real doer. Therefore, I surrender all this work to you, all the fruits of this work also to you. In return, please give me pure devotion to you. Give me your vision. If we can have a small prayer at the end of our 3 or 4 hours of work, work will become a joy. I was being transferred from Delhi after staying there for nearly 6 years in Delhi. I was transferred from there to Chirapunji, 1964. There I stayed for about more than 4 years, 64 to 68. At that time, Chirapunji work was considered as a very difficult work, very difficult from many points of view. So I was being transferred from Delhi to there, and Swami Yatishwaranji was in Bangalore. So I wrote to him, Swamiji, I am being transferred to Chirapunji. Then he wrote me saying, I am telling our attitude to work regarding that one, his instruction. He wrote me in his letter, Chirapunji work is a difficult work, no doubt. But then, do you know how to work in a difficult place? You start the work of the day with prayers to Guru Maharaj, and end the work of the day with a prayer to Guru Maharaj. Allow his divine breeze to flow throughout the day with you, and I assure you, you will do very well. You will do very well. 2 times he wrote, and I did very well. Blessings. You see, he has given the instruction, I followed it. So morning, when I went to Chirapunji, there were only 3 people there. One in charge of the big high school there, the biggest high school in Chirapunji. And one in charge of 48 middle and primary schools, another one Swami. Another one was the secretary, who was old. We were the persons to shoulder all this work. Our work would start at 5 o'clock in the morning. It would go up to almost 9 o'clock in the night. So there was no time for prayer, set for prayer. So when I went there, all through I was in Delhi, there was temple, there was prayer in the morning and evening. And before I joining Delhi, I was in Bangalore. So I knew in Bangalore Ashrama, regular prayer and meditation, I used to go there. So how to live without prayer in the morning and in the evening here? I went and started the prayer. I was in charge of a hostel with 60 tribal boys. They had a shrine, but they were not operating the shrine. I started operating it. So I found out one of the tribal young man. who could sing Kandana Bhavandana. He was an initiated person. So, I will play tabla, I know a little of it. So, you do and then someone else, some student will. We need not do arati. We will sing evening and early morning. The shrine is there, I would just go and open the shrine. No other person, senior Swami would come. Another my colleague, my own age, that Swami would not come at all, either in the morning or in the evening. In the end, his life got ruined. He had to leave the mission and go away. And I did not do anything more, doing the work, morning and evening, praying to Guru Maharaj. And this morning and evening, I would be in the shrine for minimum 1 hour, more than 1 hour also. Open the shrine, sit there for 1 hour. Evening, give the bell and that 60 boys, most of them are Christians also. I will force them, come, it is Guru Maharaj is for everybody. So you come and sit and we sing Kandana Bhavandana, all the four songs. And it became a routine. I was there for 4 years, continuously, it's morning and evening. Now it has become regular. This saved me from the difficult situation. And later on there was a tumultuous incident there. Three Swamis left in 1 day. There was such a great calamity there. I held on there. And then afterwards, another 3-4 months I was there. Then I handed over to the charge. When I look back, the whole secret is what he had taught me. Start the day with the prayers. End the day with prayers. Let the work go on with the remembrance of God. You will do very well. I am sure you will do very well. 2 times he wrote. And when that very great tragedy took place, it welled up from my inside. I never saw his letter. Read the letter again. Nobody was there by my side to remind me, Guru Maharaj, your Guru has blessed you like this. Immediately that blessing of the Guru came from inside. You will do very well. You will do very well. I had no difficulty at all in steering through the difficulty. When I came over, everybody said, how could you keep so steady and strong amid those? I never told anything. Only remembered this verse of Gurudev and that steered me through. It is true, it is very true that with the name of God, if we can continue our work, offer our work to Him, that is the best way we can work. We get joy out of work. One brahmachari, one probationary in the Delhi ashrama, always complained that he had too many works and did not find enough time to meditate. This brahmachari later on left. He came to Belur Math. He stayed here for some time. He complained to the assistant secretary of that time, Swami Shashwatanandji, who mother's disciple. He went and told him, Swami, I used to meditate more in my house. Here I don't get enough time for meditation. This brahmachari. Then that Swami said, what? In Belur Math you are unable to meditate. And you say you can meditate better in your house? Go home. And the next day morning he sent him home. He was at that time. He was a psychological case. But this brahmachari was vehemently arguing with whom? He said to Swami Sadashivananda, Bhaktaraj Maharaj, a direct disciple of Swamiji. The Swami said, as he heard this brahmachari complaining to him, he was only 1 year old brahmachari. He was telling, Swami, so much work is there. I have to do puja. I have to prepare the fruits. I have to collect the flowers. I have to do this, do that. After hearing all that, Bhaktaraj Maharaj told him, you are blessed. You are blessed. Again this boy of brahmachari said, oh no, Swami, I am unable to meditate. I have no time at all for meditation. You are blessed. You are blessed, he said again. What he meant was that you are engaged in doing so many works for Thakur. And in return, you are being purified in your mind and heart. That's what the Sadashivananda was insisting. This fellow would not understand. He went on in that restless mood. Later on, he ended up in a disaster. He left the order and went away. I, as a probationer brahmachari, wrote to Swami Yatishwaranji once, who was in Bangalore, that I was getting only 1 hour in the morning and 1 hour in the evening, apart from my duties as a pujari of the Delhi temple. I was the first brahmachari pujari of the new temple in Delhi, which was opened in 1957. So I found the work of the pujari was so much. All alone I had to do so many things. So I wrote to him, so I get only 1 hour in the morning to meditate. 1 hour in the evening, and all through the day I am busy with the work of cleaning the shrine or dressing Guru Maharaj or arranging boat for him or preparing mala for him or preparing for the aarti in the evening or mangalarti in the morning. There was no assistant, only one you have to do. So I wrote to him about that. Then Revered Maharaj wrote to me, 1 hour each time in the morning and in the evening seems to be enough. Make it qualitatively better. Try to make it better. That means make it heartfelt. Deeply from the heart you feel. And call on Guru Maharaj, 1 hour and 1 hour in the evening if you can pray, this seems to be enough. He meant again, which I had referred to that I had a lot of duties. So he meant these duties of a pujari or a great spiritual practice. It is purifying your heart. Don't think it is duty. It is a spiritual practice to work for Guru Maharaj. In the shrine, at another time also, Swami Yatishwaranji told me, connect all your works to Thakur. Think that you are serving Thakur. So from the day one we join, we must be able to start, keep steady with our prayers, at the same time with the mood that with which we are working, that we are working for Thakur. We have come to realize God, we should always remember this. This we are going to achieve. If you go on doing work, will you achieve this? Our mind will question this. So we must be able to tell our mind, this we are going to achieve through the grace of Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother. Sri Ramakrishna, that is our greatest refuge. We are going to do His work and we are going to realize God by the grace of Guru Maharaj. So Holy Mother said, Sri Ramakrishna has made the difficult task of God realization easy for every one of us through our good fortune. It is Holy Mother's talk, it is recorded. Somebody said, so easy to realize God. Holy Mother said, yes, certainly it is difficult to realize God. But Sri Ramakrishna has made the difficult task of God realization easy for us because of our good fortune. He has done so much for us. So God realization is possible, is absolutely possible. We need not have any doubt about it. Only we have to be sincere to Guru Maharaj in our work as well in our prayers and meditation. So for this, the only qualification we require, which Sri Ramakrishna requires, not only for this, for all our good, easy living, the spiritual life in the mission, only one qualification Sri Ramakrishna always insists. That is, He expects from us no other qualification except our sincerity. Manmukhakura. Let us be sincere. If you are not doing sadhana, if you are unable to do it, sincerely pray to Him. I am unable to pray, Guru Maharaj. He will lift our mind up. I may be a tamasic person. I will become rajasic and sattvic. If I am a rajasic, I will go to sattvic and then super sattvic. He is there. So we have to be sincere. If I am not able to do, let us be sincere. Let us accept. Let us not pose. So that show should go. Sincerity must come into our sadhana. For first 2 or 3 years of brahmacharis in any center, it is very important. If we do not put this habit of prayer, meditation, japa twice in a day, it becomes difficult later on to cultivate. So we have, so you are all here almost after 4 years or so, you are returning. You will see other brahmacharis joining. So you insist, you guide them. Now is the time, you must get into this routine. This practice is going to help you all your life in achieving your goal. Without cultivating our love and reverence to Thakur, all our work would seem insipid, tasteless. It is difficult to feel that we have become monastics. We would often feel the opposite, that we are just like workers or servants or employees anywhere. This thought comes to almost all of us. But at that very moment we must knock that thought down, saying, no, we have come here on our own accord. We are the servants of Sri Ramakrishna. We are not employees. We are not slaves. We are children of Sri Ramakrishna. We have come here on our own to serve. That makes the work sweet. Because it is my own will. I have come here to serve. It is a service to Sri Ramakrishna. Therefore, please be aware never to miss prayer time routine even for a day. Now regarding Japa, I have already spoken to you. See, Japa is the repetition of the mantra received from the Guru. Brahmacharis may not be initiated also when they join the mat. They should try. We can speak to our heads what we do. So whoever joins there, as early as possible, get them initiated. Because how long will they go on practicing some mantra which they have not received? So that, of course, the mission takes care of it. So we must also be insistent that we must get initiation early. In our tradition, the mantra given during initiation contains infinite power. This is what we have heard from our elders. We don't have to go again and again and then ask about the mantra. That mantra, when once it is given, it comes to us with that infinite potential power in it to take us to the highest illumination. The more we repeat, more the power of mantra is manifested and we go nearer to God realization. This is the parampara, this is the tradition, this is our belief, strong belief. More I repeat the mantra, more I am nearer to God. Hence, doing as much japa as possible is very, very welcome. Japa is the beginning. In the beginning, we do it only on finger. So even later time also, people can go on doing it with finger. They may have malas. But doing with finger has a joy of its own. Mother once said, God has given you fingers only to count the name of it. So there is a joy. So this has a special effect on our nerves. That sometimes our fingers go on counting japa. Even though we have forgotten to repeat japa from our lips, the fingers draw us to that. See, finger is moving. Oh, finger is moving. I am not repeating the mantra. Then lips also start repeating the mantra. So this is a great effect on our nerves. Naturally, we become aware that we should repeat the mantra from the lips also when the hands are pointing it to that. So I am reminded of a small incident. Swami Adhyakshanandaji, one of the great disciples of Swami Brahmanandaji. So he was in charge of our Trichur center. Now his name was really Anvartha Nama. Very, very excellently suiting name for him, Adhyakshananda. Tyaga was his main thing. He would never take anything, live on the very, very least physical support. And one of the greatest scholars our missions have produced. When you start giving lecture in the Sunday class, he would not know he has spoken for 3 hours in place of 1 hour. People have come for 1 hour lecture. He would go on talking about his subject. He would forget himself. People cannot get up and go. And he is not aware. And so inspiring would be his talk. And then when he would close, it would be three hours. I am so sorry, I have held you back. People would be grateful to him. But then, this was the Swami Adhyakshananda. Swami Adhyakshananda, one of the great disciples of Swami Brahmananda, he used to do japa on fingers. He had got so much used to it. He was bedridden in his deathbed actually. He was put in a mold. He had a back pain. It was tuberculosis of a very serious type, affecting the back. He was put in a mold where he cannot stir, move. Tremendous pain was going on. But our Swamis used to observe, his finger is going on doing japa. His finger is showing on. So in that pain also, devotees noticed, even amidst that suffering, his fingers were moving and doing japa like that. Holy Mother has said, of course, japa siddhi. Through japa alone, God realization can be achieved. Of course, we know all so many great saints. Through japa, the outside sampradaya, in our own sampradaya, Golak Ma was considered the japa siddha. Mother used to say, she is a japa siddha. She had attained God through japa. Of course, we know the Gopalermas. Through japa name alone, she attained. So all of us have got this powerful mantra with us. Let us do more japa. This is what I am driving at. Swami Yatishwarananji was also called a Japa Siddha, not by the very name like that. Swami Shivananji once remarked, showing Swami Yatishwarananji as a young Swami to other Swamis, he has attained peace through Japa. Mahapurush Maharaj used to point him. So I have seen also Swami Yatishwarananji sit for Japa when we used to serve him here. So I was the last man to leave his room at 12 o'clock sometime in the night. He would be sitting. At that time he had back pain. He had got other ailments. He was almost about 76 years at that time, or 77 years. With all that ailment, so I was to finish all the things in his room, keep his bathroom etc. ready for the next day morning, and I would be doing the duty, and only in the end I would do a pranam to go back to my room. Until then, he would be sitting on the bed with that ailing body, he would be doing japa, and I would see him, a smile on his lip, his whole face flushed with joy, and he is doing japa. I would see him with always enjoying his japa, always with a smile on his face, even when he was so physically ill, even when a serious back pain, and it was 12 o'clock in the night, this old person. You see, the joy of japa, when once it catches us, oh, that you cannot leave it, that we could see. Now, we come to the prayer. We are here, so much of prayers. Thakur Mandir, outside, you are learning also so many songs, Kali Kirtan, during Durga Puja, Kali Puja, we sing. All this, we must make a capital out of it. When we go back, we must be able to pray in whatever way we want. So Swami Yatishwarananji once told me, do you know how to keep the mind happy always? So he himself answered that, by slowly singing any beautiful song on God. He gave an example. He said, can you sing this line of the song? Ma jar anandamayi sheki niranande thake yaha kale parakale matare anande rake. Ma jar anandamayi sheki niranande thake yaha kale parakale matare anande rake. Ma jar anandamayi. Maharaj used to sing in the tune. So he sang and said, can you go on singing in this song within your own mind? This mother, whose mother is anandamayi, full of bliss, does that person who is her child ever feel misery? Mother will keep him always in joy, both here and hereafter. That is the meaning. If you go on repeating this in your mind will always be in joy. Though I have not always sung this song, many times I have sung and it has filled one with joy. So these are all tips they give. So the prayer, how it can help us. So many songs, so many of us like, I may like one song, you may like another. But go on singing that song in your mind. It will give joy, spiritual joy, that wells up inside us. Through constant prayer, we remember constantly that we are children of God. We think that prayer is something we do and forget. Through prayer, whom are we praying to? We are praying to Guru Maharaj. Guru Maharaj, we are calling his father. You are my father, you are my mother, O Lord. So we are remembering that we are his children. We are not the children of this world. I am not born to so-and-so parents in such a village on such and such a date. I am a child of God. Every day when we pray to God, we remember that we don't belong to this world, we belong to God. So this relationship is going to make us divine and give us this divine vision of the world also. All of us are children of God. That should come into our unconscious, subconscious. Sri Ramakrishna called prayer as demanding one's God for one's legitimate share, even before the proper date came. Sri Ramakrishna used to give that story. Even before you attained majority, One fellow forced his parent to give his property by pressing his demand upon them. If you don't give, I am going to go to court. So Sri Ramakrishna used to tell this. So prayer is like that. It is not a begging. Sri Ramakrishna never thought prayer as a sort of a begging, but it is only demanding what is our right. I am your child. So I am in misery and you will be in happiness. You must give me happiness. You must give me that joy, enjoyment of the spiritual world. This is the demand that we make through our prayer. One Swami Shivananji, that story of the power of the prayer which I already told you, just praying one can attain to samadhi also. Now regarding meditation, I don't have too much say, but I make a reference to it. Japa and prayer should gradually lead us to meditation. This is all our teachers have taught. In our sampradaya, so many have attained to the highest spiritual levels through japa and meditation. We should have faith that the grace of the Guru and our intense yearning for the vision of God can enable us to attain God realization. God realization is possible even today. It will continue to be. God realization will be a possible ideal for every one of us who come here. Because our grace of the Guru is there, Guru Maharaj's grace is there. We are serving them, both of them, sincerely. So by their grace, we are going to attain this God realization. That is our goal. We should never lower that goal at any time. So, in the earlier period we have heard about Narada Shankaracharya, that even now, how many people have attained to their realization of God realization? So of course Swamiji used to say, through bhakti also you can attain this Advaita realization. Gopika Gita he always used to quote. Sri Ramakrishna went into Samadhi. He went into Samadhi in front of hundreds of householders and of course a few monastic disciples. Both Savikalka Samadhi he has demonstrated to the common public, common householders. Nirvikalpa Samadhi also he has demonstrated. Several times in a day, he made even ordinary householders feel that Samadhi is possible for them through his grace in this Kali Yuga. Even householders, you know, he has made them believe this. We are sadhus, chosen children of him. We should never at any moment think, oh, is God realization possible for us? It will be possible for next 1500 years until this mission, it fully fulfills its mission. Perhaps a new mission will come. According to Swamiji, the message of Sri Ramakrishna, which he has given to the world, will last for 1500 years. 1500 years there will be God realized persons in this. Not every one of us may realize, because every one of us, we don't struggle hard. If every one of us struggle equally hard, every one of us will be God realized persons. That is the possibility, that is the potentiality in us. So we should never lose this great message of Sri Ramakrishna demonstrating his samadhi to ordinary householders also, saying God realization is possible in this Kali Yuga if we are sincere to him by his grace. And in our own tradition, Swami Brahmananji blessed. About Brahmananji and direct disciple, we need not bother at all. They are the topmost, next only to Sri Ramakrishna. Next generation also, Swami Brahmananji blessed Swami Nirvananji, Surji Maharaj, who was here as manager for so many decades. We have all seen him. So, you will have Brahma Jnana. Swami Brahmananji blessed him. And many people who have seen him, we have also seen him in the last stage. Whatever you would utter in a very normal way would come true. One Swami went to Swami Nirvananji. There was some strike going on in our Rahada center. This Swami went there. He saw that one and then he did something there to pacify those people. Came back to Swami Nirvananji and reported to him, Swami Maharaj, I went there, that Rahada was burning. There was strike going on. He is telling Nirvananji that Rahada was burning. I went and quenched that fire and came. Swami Nirvananji looked at him. First quench the fire that is there in your heart. This Swami left after a month or two, 1.5 months. You see, he is reporting. It was true. He did not look at that fire. He is looking at the fire of this. A Brahmajnani. So in our own time, we have seen they are there. So when it has come down, will it stop there? What force can stop it? Sri Ramakrishna's power is flowing. Every one of us have the possibility of becoming a Brahmajnani. Swami Yatishwarananji, his rights, you see, there is recorded reminiscences of him. He says, I felt the infinite presence of God when Swami Brahmananji was in Madras. Yatishwarananji was doing aarti after his sannyas, just after his sannyas, the Madras shrine. Swami Brahmananji was standing behind. Swami Yatishwarananji writes, I felt the infinite presence of God pervading me, pervading my Gurudev, pervading the whole devotees there. Infinite presence, God realization, it is there. So it is coming down to us, that stream is there. Swami Yatishwaranji told one of his disciples, we know what Samadhi is, we can rob ourselves in it for some time. But the direct disciples have not asked us to be absorbed in Samadhi. They have asked to serve God in everyone. Are we not doing the same thing? Don't you see? This is the present tense of what Sri Ramakrishna, we have put him in the past. He cannot, he will not go into past, he will always be present. So this is the power of Sri Ramakrishna and his parampara. We have behind us, this great parampara is there, always ready to help us. If only we try a little, we have only to struggle, try in the path that has been shown to us sincerely. By the grace of Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, Swami Vivekanandaji, Swami Brahmananji and our own Gurus, all of us can experience God realization, which is the goal of our lives. Hence, let us apply ourselves to spiritual practices, to japa, prayer and meditation. Diligently. May Guru Maharaj, Holy Mother and Swamiji bless us all and lead us to our fulfillment. Thank you very much. Niranjanam Nityamanantarupam Bhaktanukampadrita Vigraham Vai Ishavataram Parameshamidyam Tamramakrishnam Shirasanama.
Ache karmam emundayamaye amader matume jam. Ache karmam emundayamaye amader matume jam. Tumi sangeta kadi banisim sangeta kadi banisim sukhe at corona kapa tumi sangeta kadi banisim sukhe at corona kapa ache karmam emundayamoye amader matumi jam. Ache karmam emundayamoye amader matumi jaman. Hari karan la jalem apni damata te felem. Hari karan la jalem apni dao mata te felem apni dao ma upay bole apni dao ma upay bole je bhabe jar bache jivan apni dao ma upay bole je bhabe jar bache jivan ache karmam emundayamoye amader matume jam ache karmam emundayamoye amader matume jam. ভালো বাসো যেমন আমি তো বাসি না তেমন, তুমি ভালো বাসো যেমন আমি তো বাসি না তেমন, ভালোবাসা শিখাও আমায়, ভালোবাসা শিখাও আমায়, আমায় ভালোবাসো যেমন, ভালোবাসা শিখাও আমায়, আমায় ভালোবাসো যেমন, আছে কর্মম এমন দয়াময়ী আমাদের মা তুমি যেমন, আছে কর্মম এমন দয়াময়ী আমাদের মা তুমি যেমন, তুমি সঙ্গে থাক দিবারিসে, সঙ্গে থাক দিবারিসে, সুখে আট করো না কখন, তুমি সঙ্গে থাক দিবারিসে, সুখে আট করো না কখন, আছে কর্মম এমন দয়াময়ী আমাদের মা তুমি যেমন, আছে কর্মম এমন দয়াময়ী আমাদের মা তুমি যেমন। ওম শান্তি 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 হে হরি ওম তৎসত শ্রী রামকৃষ্ণার্পণমস্তু, জয় শ্রী গুরু মহারাজ কে, জয় জয় মহামায়ী কে, জয় জয় স্বামীজি মহারাজ কে, জয় জয় গঙ্গা মায়ী কে, জয়।
অল অফ আস উইল অফার প্রণামস টু রিভিয়ার্ড মহারাজ।
মহামন্ডলেশ্বর